Good morning, everyone. It's good to see you all, and welcome to those who may be watching online sometime later than today. It's good to see you. The psalmist writes like this: I will proclaim your greatness, my God and King. I will thank you forever and ever. Every day I will thank you. I will praise you forever and ever. The Lord is great and is to be highly praised. His greatness is beyond understanding. What you have done will be praised from one generation to the next. They will proclaim your mighty acts. Let's pray. Almighty God, we thank you for that glorious picture that the psalmist has, and that confidence that he has in you, enabled to praise and thank you from day to day. We pray for the ability to always remember that for ourselves too. And so we commit this time to you and ask your blessing in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The theme is harvest this morning, and so I know we sang a harvest hymn last week to finish, but we're going to sing the good old harvest hymn this morning as our first hymn. Come, you thankful people, come, raise the song of harvest home. Got a guest appearance this morning. David Page is going to come and read the scriptures for us. Thank you, David.
I'm reading from the Good News Bible, We have two readings. The first is Psalm 65. O God, it is right for us to praise you in Zion and keep our promises to you, because you answer prayers. People everywhere will come to you on account of their sins. Our faults defeat us, but you forgive them. Happy are those whom you choose, whom you bring to live in your sanctuary. We shall be satisfied with the good things of your house, the blessings of your sacred temple. You answer us by giving us victory, and you do wonderful things to save us. People all over the world and across the distant seas trust in you. You set the mountains in place by your strength, showing your mighty power. You calm the roar of the seas and the noise of the waves. You calm the uproar of the peoples. The whole world stands in awe of you, of the great things that you have done. Your deeds bring shouts of joy from one end of the earth to the other. You show your care for the land by sending rain. You make it rich and fertile. You fill the streams with water. You provide the earth with crops. This is how you do it. You send abundant rain on the ploughed fields and soak them with water. You soften the soil with showers and cause the young plants to grow. What a rich harvest your goodness provides. Wherever you go, there is plenty. The pastures are filled with flocks. The hillsides are full of joy. The fields are covered with sheep. The valleys are full of wheat. Everything shouts and sings for joy. Our second reading is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 8, verses 11 to 15, where Jesus explains the parable of the sower. This is what the parable means. The seed is the word of God. The seeds that fell along the path stand for those who hear, but the devil comes and takes the message away from their hearts in order to keep them from believing and being saved. The seeds that fell on rocky ground stand for those who hear the message and receive it gladly. But it does not sink deep into them. They believe only for a while, but when the time of testing comes, they fall away. The seeds that fell among thorn bushes stand for those who hear, but the worries and riches and pleasures of this life crowd in and choke them, and their fruit never ripens. The seeds that fell in good soil stand for those who hear the message and retain it in a good and obedient heart, and they persist until they bear fruit. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you very much, David. And that psalm that I'm going to be looking at more, especially than the parable of the sower, is an amazing psalm, isn't it? You think of this glorious picture of the greatness of God. You may have heard the story of a man driving down a country road when he spots someone standing out in the middle of a cornfield. And he thought it was probably a scarecrow. And as he was getting closer, he thought his curiosity got the better of him. And he stopped the car and he went up and he found it was an individual standing in the cornfield. And so he said, what are you doing? Do you mind me asking? Well, the person said, I'm trying to win a Nobel Prize. Well, how on earth do you do that? I'd expect to do that, said the driver. Well, I heard that the Nobel Prize is given to people who are outstanding in their field. We can think in terms of being outstanding in the field of life in the sense of what God means to us. And when it comes to harvest, we have this thing, and I read on Facebook this morning of a church in Mid Wales announcing that the Thanksgiving will be held on the 6th of October, I think it is, in this particular church. When I was brought up, that's how we referred to the harvest service. It may have been an occasion, the harvest Thanksgiving, but Thanksgiving was always there. We've changed that now, and it's just become the harvest service. But we know what it means, and we do give thanks for it. Always the question, when are we going to have our Thanksgiving this year? Who are we going to invite as the preacher? And people would give names and so on. This psalm is about how we approach God at such times as this, as to who he is. And the first thing I want to highlight is that he emphasizes the God who is gracious. You answer prayer, you forgive sins, and we sing and be thankful of the ripened fruit and the matured grain, don't we? And whether it's in the garden or in the field, we think in terms of hard work being rewarded. There can so easily be the feeling of all good gifts around us are sent from heaven above, and so we thank the Lord for his love. But when we think seriously about it, do we really deserve his goodness? Surely not one of us would say that because we have done such wonderful things for God, he is duty bound to honor us and to bless us and to show mercy to us and so on. But you noticed in the explanation of the parable of the sower, it's a rather lovely way in which Luke puts it. I mean, it's inferred in the other Gospels, but Luke says the seed is the word of God. The seed that fell along the path, you know, the birds come and they take it away. And what Jesus is saying, the devil comes and he can take the message away from us if we're not careful. We may be thrilled with the service and then we go outside, and then we're back to normal and we're talking about yesterday's rugby or football or something like that, and the seed is gone. Some fell on rocky ground. Yes, they believe for a while, but then the tests come, the challenges come, and the seed is gone. Some fell among thorns, and then, says Jesus, there's the worries and pleasures of life. They choke the message, and the fruit never really ripens. And some seed fell in good soil. They grow and bear fruit. I don't know about you, but I'm left each time I read that. What kind of soil? What kind of soil am I? The seed is the word of God. How do we respond to this gracious God and to what his word says to us from day to day? I mean, how do we cope? How do we cope with someone who's upset us and we feel so very hurt and we give them the cold shoulder? And forgiveness, is it part of our daily lives? And in a few minutes' time, we'll be praying the Lord's Prayer. You know, there's a condition in the Lord's Prayer, isn't there? Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Well, to say it's a condition perhaps is overdoing it, but this gracious God isn't quite like that, but it does remind us. And then Apostle Paul talks often about we've been called out of darkness into his marvelous light. Thankfully, though, he doesn't wait for us to become good enough. He doesn't bless us with a good harvest because he's rewarding us for what we've done for him. He's always ready to reach out to us. He's always ready to forgive us, not because we've been good, not because we are worthy servants. He does this because of what, not because of what we are, but despite what we are, when we come reverently before him and admit where we've gone wrong. This God who is gracious. The second thing we notice, this God who is powerful. People all over the world trust in you. You set the mountains in place, showing your mighty power. The whole world stand in awe of the great things you have done. And the psalmist builds up this glorious picture of this powerful God. And harvest should be the reminder to us that God is always there. Of course we sing, and we will in a few minutes. We plough the fields and scatter the good seed on the land. We dug the garden, we planted, true. But there's more than that, isn't there? The soil has to be worked. The soil is fed with fertilizer, and the ground is ready to receive the seed. And then this powerful God gets to work. As someone has said, God's fingerprints can be seen everywhere. Paul, in writing the Corinthian church, and there were real problems in that church, and there were some there who said, well, I won't go today because so-and-so is preaching, or I won't be there tomorrow because so-and-so. And Paul says, no, it's not like that. I may have planted the seed, but remember, it is Apollos that watered the plant. But remember this, it is God who gives the growth. That's really how this powerful God breaks into our lives, isn't it? I've often told the story, and I won't give the details now, but many of you have heard it anyway, but I knew this burly chap who, his wife printed our newsletter each week when I was in my last church, and I'd take the material for the newsletter to the house, and I got there this particular day, and I usually plan it for the evening when she was home from work, and he was home from work. And he came in, of course, because I was there, but there was one of these three-seater settees, and I was in an armchair, and he sat on the far end of the three-seater, not to come too close, and we started talking and so on, and I said, by the way, are you interested in cricket? Well, not since I left school, he said, but, I said, we're trying to get a team together in the church, would you come? And he came, and eventually friendships developed, and he came to a baptismal service, and I made the appeal at the end of the service, and he came forward, and he told me afterwards, do you know, he said, I can't remember a thing. I think if I'd been roped to the seat, I'd probably have brought it with me, he said, because I remember just standing at the front of the church. This powerful God had broken through into what I would have said was an unlikely character. You know, we write people off sometimes, don't we? Oh, we'll never get through to them. But God will. God will. Wouldn't it be strange if we felt full of gratitude and discovered that there was no one to receive our thanks? Wouldn't that be strange? This powerful God brought light out of darkness of the cross. Yes, Christ died, but he rose again. This glorious light shone through of a living Saviour who one day now reigns in heaven, but one day will come again. This God who is powerful. And then thirdly and finally, this God who is generous. In those verses, they highlight our dependence upon God. He waters the fields and all of that, and he enriches the ground for us to have the harvest. Yes, it's full of it there in that psalm. Beautiful. What a rich harvest your goodness provides. This God who is generous. We see pictures of on television often, don't we, of starving people in the world. We see the picture of the situation in Libya, that horrible, horrible situation where families were washed away, homes were destroyed, and all of that. And it takes some believing. We see the pictures, but then there's the earthquake in Morocco, isn't it? Earthquake in Morocco and the damage that's done. And we see all of these things, and then we read that 854 million people in the world are undernourished. There's so much. And then over the weekend here at Ararat, we've been asking for, the church has been asking for hard-working farmers in Uganda to be supported in the work they're doing for families and so on. This psalmist is reminding us that God has blessed us abundantly. But the problem, so often, we're unwilling to share. Count your blessings, do you know that? And name them one by one. I wonder how often we do that. By contrast, this gracious, generous God who's given us so much is ever ready to offer us a new start. I end with a story, a real story, true story of a hospital chaplain. He would enter this particular hospital on a Tuesday morning. He'd go into a particular ward, and the first bed on the left, as soon as he was into the ward, there was a man there with an onslaught of abuse and colourful language and hand gestures. And the chaplain's response was simply, "God bless you." And this went on week after week after week. And then one week he went in, and this man said, "Excuse me, chaplain," he said, "why are you so nice to me when I'm so rude to you?" The chaplain said, "Well, you see, I believe Jesus loves everybody despite what we do or say. And it is my desire for everyone to get to know him," he said. "Would you like a personal relationship with him?" he said to this man. "Yes, but what would I say?" And the chaplain said, "Well, imagine that Jesus is sitting in that chair by your bed. And just talk to him," he said. "Would you like me to say a prayer?" And the man agreed, and he prayed that this man would give his heart to the Lord. Following Tuesday, the chaplain visited the ward, and the bed was empty. He made inquiries, and they said, "Sadly, he's passed away. But you know, you must know that in the last days of his life, he was a changed man. He was saying please and thank you, and he was so kind and appreciative to everybody, we couldn't quite believe it. And the interesting thing is, the day he died, he was in that chair, and his arms wrapped around the chair." And the chaplain smiled to himself. And he realized that this man had died in the arms, or the arms of Jesus around him. John's Gospel says, "To those who receive him and believe in his name, he gives them the right to become God's children." There are reports, and there was one report not so long ago, 25% of the people in the United Kingdom, now that's a lot of people, 25% of the population of this country followed a church service during lockdown. Who knows what God is doing and how he can break in? This God who is gracious, this God who is powerful, this God who is generous. And probably for that last story, it began with this gracious chaplain, not arguing with the man or telling him to shut up, but simply, "God bless you." And God breaks through in wonderful ways. Let's pray. Almighty God, we bring you our thanks today. We think in terms of a thanksgiving service. For everything you have given us, you have blessed us with so much. We thank you for the infinite beauty of this world, this complex universe. And yet we are disturbed by the fact that there's so much bitterness and anger in so many parts of the world, so much jealousy and envy, and people wanting to own more than is rightly theirs, or bulldoze their way into other countries, into other people's lives. And we do think today, particularly of the Morocco earthquake and the devastation in Libya and all the other areas where there is devastation. While we can give you thanks, there are those who are wondering how they will survive, and not to mention Ukraine and all the other war-torn areas. But we thank you that you have graciously blessed, and we can only just say what life is for us in these days and how we take so much for granted and how we've become lackadaisical about our faith and how we do things. Does it really matter? Is it that important? Forgive us, Lord. Forgive us when we forget the amazing story, the amazing picture of the cross, and what you suffered, and how you died. And even from the cross, you could say, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And so we give you our thanks and praise today and ask your blessing. We ask your blessing upon each one here this morning. You know what people are going through, and those who may be listening later on YouTube, you know where they're at and what they're going through. Grant them your peace. And for each one of us, perhaps, we need something of your peace in our hearts today. And so hear these our prayers. Bless each family and home that's represented here now, as we offer all things in the name of Jesus. And we remember our dear friend and brother especially, who has led these services so often, Mansell Jones. We pray that you'll bless him, make him aware of your inner strength and peace as he endures treatment just now. And all of this we ask in Jesus' name. And shall we say the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And so, as promised, we will sing that final hymn, "We plough the fields and scatter the good seed on the land, but it is fed and watered by God's almighty hand."
Thank you.
should have said we continue to pray for Mike here, who is also going through treatment and conscious of your situation. There may be others of you. You are in our thoughts and prayers today. And now may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with us all today and forevermore. Amen.